This is Gary Geck from GaryGeck.com. Welcome to part 22 of my 42-part video series revealing the secret history. For parts 22 through 28, which stand on their own, I will be exploring the life and work of a man often called the greatest logician since Aristotle. In this video, I will be exploring the mind of Kurt Gödel. This will not be a mere biography, but a revelation to the world of who he really was. Kurt Gödel, who considered nearly all of modern thought, especially the analytic tradition, to be dehumanizing and backwards. A man whose results continue to shock the world. Who married his sweetheart Adele, a beautiful nightclub dancer. Who believed in God and Platonism in dramatic opposition to the zeitgeist. Who proved the limitations of formal systems and yet believed that the mind could solve any problem. A man obsessed with Snow White and fairy tales because they showed how meaningful the world should be. Who believed in a vast conspiracy to keep mankind stupid and empirical instead of knowing the full power of conceptual truth. In fact, Gödel believed that this dark conspiratory force was after him the same way they were after Leibniz. This is Kurt Gödel. Many of the shallower works on Gödel are dismissive of his work outside of logic on the grounds of his mental issues. There's no question that Gödel struggled with his demons, but I feel that the real story is so much deeper and more interesting. I would like to begin this story with a quote from page 13 of Kurt Gödel, the album, which eloquently puts such demons into context. Quote, Gödel's intellectual adventures exacted a high price. He repeatedly suffered from severe psychological crises and breakdowns, and spent much time in sanatoriums. The director of his institute described him in an official letter as a genius with psychopathological traits. Gödel was haunted by the fear of being poisoned, and in the end, he died from his determination not to take up any food. In the intervals between his crises, or states as he called them, he could be funny, brilliant, and extremely stimulating. But in Gödel's presence, his close friend, Oscar Morgenstern, always felt the chill from another world. Gödel himself was well aware that many of his opinions were not shared by the majority. He was an unadulterated Platonist. He was intensely interested in theology, the real one, with proofs of God's existence. And as a time traveler, he would probably have visited Leibniz first. In a list of his philosophical principles, he notes, first, the world is rational. This by itself sounds oddly out of tune with his time. What Gödel had to live through was everything but rational, even without his states and fears. As he told Hao Wang in one of their long interviews, I do not fit into this century. And yet he left his mark on it, maybe precisely because he remained a stranger. Unquote. Despite these personal states, Gödel's few publications changed the world of mathematics, logic, and philosophy. To this day, we are still struggling to understand what are the implications of his work. To call Kurt Gödel interesting is an understatement. One of Gödel's closest friends at the IAS at Princeton was Albert Einstein, who once told Morgenstern that in the later years, his own work didn't mean that much, and, quote, that he came to the Institute merely to have the privilege of walking home with Gödel, unquote. To get a better understanding, I would like to go back to Vienna in the mid to late 1920s. Gödel began college at the University of Vienna in physics, but quickly changed to philosophy and mathematics. Gödel saw philosophy and mathematics as more fruitful enterprises than physical science to understand reality. To Gödel, reality extended well beyond that which is available to the sense organs that science is so preoccupied with. In a Platonic tradition, Gödel included the world of ideas in his view of reality. In such a world, mathematics and logic were not only tools to be applied, but tools of revelation when they were correct. But Gödel was sharp and meticulous, never loose with his speculations, which were always held up to the highest rigor in his own mind. To him, publishing an error or a claim that was not obvious to the intuition would have been an unbearable embarrassment. In Gödel was the combination of perfectionism and powers of discrimination to the extreme on the one hand, but on the other, an open and expanded mind to the mystical. A combination that GaryGeck.com has long argued is the perfect recipe for genius. It is revealing that, according to Dr. Gerald Sachs, in a lecture I will quote often in this series, Gödel requested that the logic journals at Princeton be moved from the science wing of the library to the wing of humanities. A link to Dr. Sachs's lecture on Gödel, which is the best lecture I've ever heard on the topic, will be available on GaryGeck.com in the podcast section. It is remarkable that the young Gödel developed with such a Platonic philosophical worldview. Between 1926 and 1929, he often sat in on a group usually characterized by vehement hatred towards metaphysics and speculative thinking. Called the Vienna Circle, it was a group which associated with the mathematics department at the University of Vienna and often met in cafes. Among coffee and cigarettes, philosophic polemics often raged, but Gödel, according to Karl Menger, usually sat quietly listening, only making head gestures in agreement or disagreement with what was being said. Gödel's 1929 doctoral dissertation showed his powerful genius early on. It contained fundamental results in logic, specifically his completeness theorem, which answered positively a question that David Hilbert and Wilhelm Ackermann had posed in 1928. I will go into much more detail on completeness in a different video in this 42-part series. But briefly, Gödel proved that all valid first-order logical expressions are provable. No small feat. One consequence of the completeness theorem is that it made the connection between semantics and syntax explicit. But we will get into this more later. Shortly after Gödel was awarded his doctorate, he discovered what he is most famous for today, his two incompleteness theorems. Again, other videos in this series will go into much more detail about the incompleteness phenomenon because it is so central to our main story.
It upset a lot of people when it first came out. I knew someone who was there the night the news came to Göttingen, and of course they couldn't go to sleep, and they looked at the proof and so on. And a lot of people were upset. They thought he was doing great damage to mathematics, but I think he made mathematics more interesting. So now when you attack a problem, for all you know, it may be one of the undecidable ones.
Gödel's incompleteness theorems were not fully appreciated for a while, but eventually, partly thanks to John von Neumann, some of their implications became clear. But to this day, the full implications of incompleteness phenomenon is debated. Gödel eventually made his way to set theory and made important contributions to that field. Remember that set theory played an important role in parts 1 through 7 of this video series. Gödel, in a way, carried on the work of set theory's father, Georg Cantor, who, like Gödel, had deep Platonic philosophical views of mathematics. In the previously mentioned lecture by Dr. Sachs, it's mentioned that one of Gödel's favorite topics to discuss was the absolute. As I discussed in parts 1 through 7, in Cantorian set theory, the absolute is the set of all sets. It is the highest infinity, encompassing the many seemingly unbounded infinities of other infinities. Cantor might have viewed it as the God set. Naturally, the concept of the absolute seems contradictory, but Cantor seemed to have accepted this as a natural quality of the divine. In fact, a long tradition going back to the German Hermetic theologian Nicholas of Cusa viewed God as the coincidence of opposites. This is not to say that Gödel's God was irrational, but an example of the paradoxes in naive set theory, the set of all sets must contain members not in itself. Because of these issues, Cantor classified the absolute as an inconsistent set. He divided all sets into those which were consistent on the one hand and those which were inconsistent on the other. While mathematicians continued to deal exclusively with the consistent sets through the development of mathematics over the past century, it is interesting that the absolute was resurrected in modern formal axiomatic set theories as the class of all sets, that is, the proper class of all sets. Let us listen again briefly to a clip from Dr. Sachs's lecture on this.
So there was this dinner once at the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton. I would sit next to him at dinner and that is Gödel and keep him out of trouble and so on. On the other side of him, he had an old friend, Oscar Morgenstern. So we spoke during the dinner, and of course, I was always eager to hear whatever he had to say. And he brought up, I don't know why, he brought up one of his favorite concepts, the absolute, with a capital A. That's not a concept that 20th century philosophers tend to bring up, the absolute. So what was it to him? In my mind, it was the class of all sets, but maybe it was something more for him, I'm not sure. But he seemed to be talking about the class of all sets, hence of all mathematical objects. So that's worthy of being called the absolute. And he says, and he told me, you know, and he seemed to have this boyish enthusiasm. He says, you know, language does not enable us to define the absolute.
Right.
If you had a formula f of x, it can never happen that that formula has exactly one x that satisfies it, that x being the absolute. That can't happen, because we know from the reflection principle in set theory, if I have a formula f of x and f of v holds, where v is the class of all sets, then f must also hold for some set. In other words, anything you say about the class of all sets, which is true, is also true for some particular set. And hence, you can't define the absolute. And he said, and then his eyes lit up. He said, isn't that wonderful? We know something important about the absolute just by logic, just by reason. And he was full of enthusiasm.
Please continue on to part 23 of this video series on Kurt Gödel. And check out all of the videos at GaryGeck.com.